In 1939, a 19-year-old piano player made his way into an after-hours jazz club in Harlem to listen to whatever musicians might stop by after their gig, to sit in and talk trash with other denizens of the night. His name was Alan Tinney. The opportunity to sit in on piano with some of these players landed him on the stage, and apparently he did well. Clark Monroe, the owner of Monroe's Uptown House, approached him after he played and offered him a job as leader of the house band. He was reluctant to take another man's job, but Mr. Monroe explained that the position would be open at the end of the night, either way, take it or leave it. He took it. Over time, Al Tinney learned that the players that sat in regularly were not just some local players. They were unknown at the time, but they were a young personable trumpet player known as Dizzy Gillespie, a sax man from Kansas City named Charlie Parker. From time to time, a lovely young singer named Billie Holliday stopped by, and a wonderfully creative drummer, Max Roach, sat in with the band at Monroe's.
We would start at Georgie J's about 9 o'clock, finish at 3, pack up our gear, run uptown to Harlem, 134th to 133rd Street, I forget now, where Monroe's Uptown House was, which is called an after-hour illegitimate house, and we would play until the wee hours of the next day. And that's where I first met Alan. He was a phenomenal pianist, but it was during a period in New York City where people of musicians of Alan's age and my age, or younger or older, kind of dominated the scene, because it was during the war, and most of the veteran musicians, that is, like Papa Joe Jones and Lester Young and folks like that, were in the Army.
When it all started at Monroe's, the music that they were playing was related to show tunes and the swing that the country had come to know and love. But by the time Al Tinney himself joined the service, something new had been born. It wasn't called bebop then, but the spark had been lit.
Well, I want to tell you, he would put fire on that stage when we had that little band down there with Victor Coulson and Charlie Parker and the rest of us. And no matter who would come in to do some impromptu performing with the group in Monroe's Uptown House, who would invite everybody in, he would always be the person who could find out where all the singers were. He seemed to know all the songs and everything at that particular time.
After putting in his time in the Army, Tinney returned to New York to find that the music scene that he had helped to ignite had moved downtown to 52nd Street. This in itself was not a problem. The problem was what had become of his fellow musicians. This generation of highly creative, innovative musicians had started to delve into the drug scene, and Al Tinney would have none of it.
Contrary to all the rest of us who did everything you can possibly imagine, as far as I can recall, Alan was always on Clean Street. I can't remember Alan smoking and doing all the crazy things that the rest of us were doing during that period. Now, Alan, it was during this time when I moved down to 52nd Street with Dizzy and Don Byas and that crowd, that Alan then disappeared. This was about, now this is 43, yeah, this is 43 I'm talking now.
Almost immediately upon his return to New York City, Tinney took his leave from the bebop scene, but not without having influenced his fellow players. When he left the scene, his presence was missed because he was a leader among New York musicians.
But I often wondered what had happened, because he was different. I mean, he had the same kind of ambitions, and he was as aggressive as all the rest of us, because you couldn't survive during that period if you weren't. But then all of a sudden, he just disappeared. So he went to the Army. See Charlie Parker, Dizzy, myself, we never went to the Army. But we were ripe for it because we were all around the same age, you know, Charlie Parker, Dizzy, and myself. And J.J. Johnson, of course, and Sonny Stitt, all the young musicians around New York at that particular time. Elmo Hope was around then, as well as a pianist. But he didn't dominate the scene as Alan did. Bud, when we were working at Monroe's Uptown House, Bud was on the scene, but he wasn't a dominant force on the scene like Alan was. He was the piano of note during that time, during the musicians who were in their early 20s.
When he got back to the city, many things were different, including to some degree the cast of characters. Al Tinney remembers.
Well, I heard all these names floating around, like Cecil Payne and Lockjaw Davis, and George Treadwell became, a trumpet player in my brother-in-law's band, where he met Sarah Vaughan. And then there was the Pritchard brothers, and then there was Duke Jordan. Remember Duke, piano player? And I was instrumental in showing him some things that I had been doing with the band. And then he emerged as a celebrity piano player, and I emerged as an unknown, as usual.